There is a reciprocal relationship between the mind and the body, that a person who has good physical fitness also needs to have good mental fitness. Good physical fitness contributes to mental fitness, and good mental fitness can contribute to physical fitness. Think about a person, for example, who's depressed. Are they going to be interested in exercising? Probably not. So one of the things I know from a recent major speech by the Department of Defense, Secretary of Defense, was that he has determined that going forward, resilience and mental fitness is going to be on an equal playing field to what has traditionally been important in the military, and that is physical fitness. In other words, both are very important, and being able to assess cognitive fitness and mental fitness will be an important variable going forward, as it is for everyone. As a clinical neuropsychologist and clinical psychologist, reliability and validity are extremely important. Does the test measure what it purports to measure? Is it valid? And is it reliable? Am I going to get varying differences from one time to another? Can I have trust and faith in the test in itself? So this is very important. When I first was introduced to the CNS Vital Signs, I didn't do a formal study. However, I did compare the results of the CNS Vital Signs with several patients that I had done a full battery on. And I was able to find that I was surprised and happy to see that the findings that I got on some of the tests that I used were very similar. And therefore, that gave me confidence that the computerized neuropsychological assessment was something I could probably use and incorporate into my practice as a screening tool. The question becomes, how do we measure mental fitness? Well, to some extent, traditionally, you know, psychology has been at the forefront of this. World War I, World War II, and so forth, they developed various assessment scales for people coming into the military to determine how they could classify them into particular job sets. These paper and pencil tests are still used today, and they're very important. But now with the advent of neurocognitive assessment, we're now going to be able to take a look at the neurocognitive functioning of recruits, people coming in, and be able to help enhance that cognitive functioning and be able to determine, in addition to the paper and pencil tests, what particular areas they are suited for and best at, and assess that over time going forward to make sure that we are on track with having a very fit mental military as well as physically fit military. CNS Vital Signs platform is particularly useful not only as a standalone, but it can be used as an internet-based application for telemedicine and telebehavioral health. It can be used in a primary care setting. It can be used as a routine kind of screening. I know that there's talk into the future about doing routine cognitive screenings or cognitive health screenings like you would do an annual physical. And so I think that the application lends itself to being used in a variety of settings where the importance of measuring cognitive performance and emotional factors associated with cognitive performance or neurobehavioral assessment is very important. And I think you're going to see this application being used that way much more so in the future. One of the nice things about the CNS Vital Signs neurocognitive assessment platform is that you can assess these various domains of cognitive fitness, memory, attention, processing speed, executive functioning, problem solving, if you will, at a very core basic level. And in addition to that, take a look at the potential areas of weakness for resilience when you can measure with some of the questionnaires alongside of the computerized platform the ability to take a look at those as well, to look at a whole package of where this person is in terms of their mental neurocognitive fitness. One of the things that 10 years of war has resulted in is a multitude of issues that we have to be concerned about, whether that be the mild traumatic brain injury that the soldier may have experienced in theater, or the symptoms of combat stress or post-traumatic stress disorder. Sometimes substance abuse is an issue. Pain is frequently an issue with soldiers returning from combat. Therefore, having the CNS Vital Signs platform that not only does a neurocognitive assessment, but also does the questionnaire assessment, the assessment of their neurobehavioral data, is very important to be able to get a better understanding of the patient and then to move on from there with either assessment or treatment as needed. My experience is that service members returning from theater have comorbidities in many cases, not always, but in many cases. Are we dealing with depression? Are we dealing with an anxiety disorder of some type? Are we dealing with chronic or acute pain symptoms? Are we dealing, and this is a big, big issue with our service members, is sleep deprivation. They do night missions in many cases, and so their sleep-wake cycle is disturbed. So just because I get a lower score on, say, a memory domain or the attention domain does not necessarily mean that we're dealing with an acquired brain injury. It may be these comorbidities that are resulting in less cognitive efficiency, and therefore we have to move forward with additional assessment, perhaps some treatment, sleep medicine intervention, and then reassess and see whether or not cognition has improved. What I have found is that computerized neurocognitive assessment helps me to be a much more efficient clinician. It adds efficiency to the process, and it really helps us and guide us to go forward with further assessments so that we truly do get as best a diagnostic picture as we can.